Hey everyone, I'm Mike Prue from Hill Holliday and co-author of the book Social TV, and I'm at Twitter's headquarters in San Francisco with Chloe Sladen and Robin Sloan of Twitter Media. Really excited to be here and just asking them a couple questions about how Twitter has changed television as we know it. Robin, let's start with you. So one of the great things about Twitter is that it's really simple to use, it's straightforward, and it's also very open. How would you say Twitter has changed television the most?
I think that for the last several years, everyone has sort of shared this assumption that the move away from live TV is just inevitable and sort of inexorable, towards things like demand viewing and Netflix and iTunes and whatever else. And it's definitely the case that those things are important and they're actually going to get bigger and even more popular. But I think Twitter has given people a real reason to watch live again. I think it's revealed the conversations and the kind of thoughts and reactions that have always been there for live programming, and just giving people a reason to kind of show up at the same time together and have that social experience that we think of as being as very old-fashioned,
totally.
But it's actually like something very modern.
And Chloe, at this point, you guys now have done a lot of different partnerships directly with television networks. When you look back on everything that you've done, which is the one that you're most proud of?
That's easy. I'll start with the record that we just broke. We had 10 million VMA-related tweets in the 2011 VMAs and a tweets per second record with Beyoncé's Baby Bump. But I would say it's tough between the 2009 and the 2010 VMAs because 2009 was the first effort. But 2010 really stands out for me because it was the first time Twitter was integrated into the very dynamic and fabric of the show. That giant hero screen, which had the total tweets about the show and had the ranking of the nominees and performers and artists by their hashtags. So the audience really quickly understood, without any explanation, that their tweets were going to change who got that moment of spotlight, who was being given that sort of Twitter approval. And that, I mean, first of all, it was a huge screen, and so it was literally in the set, and it was very much a part of the show. And then just the fact that it was so dynamic and respectful of the audience and beautiful, it didn't look nerdy or cheesy. It was actually, MTV and Dave Strolnick and Michael Scoggin did a great job of really making it feel natural to the show. So that was the first time that we achieved our vision of this true melding of Twitter and TV in look and feel and emotion.
Robin, I know that one of the things that you guys do is you monitor the back channel when this is happening. You're collecting lots of data. Is there things that you look back on all the partnerships that you've done that the data is telling you something that is particularly surprising?
This might not be surprising to folks in the TV industry, but I think for folks who work on the web or maybe just are not quite as familiar with TV, this can be really surprising. When you look at the Twitter conversation around a show, it's sort of a background level. We sometimes call it background radiation for the week and even for the day and even in the hours leading up to the show. And then literally, at the moment that the show starts, any kind of graph we do, whether it's tweets per second or tweets per minute, literally shoots straight up. It's like a cliff face, and it shoots straight up to whatever the kind of standard rate is for that show, whether it's 100 tweets a minute or 1,000 tweets a minute, and it stays up there, kind of zigzagging up and down until the show ends, and then literally it falls back down to that background radiation level. And it just connects back to that point about live viewership, about like people are watching live, and maybe more importantly, they're engaging live. Like, the time you're watching the show is actually the time you want to talk about the show, way more so than before or after. And that's something we've learned by just looking at the data again and again.
Chloe, there's no doubt that Twitter is a big part of the television experience. When it comes to putting on a network exec hat, should Twitter be the entire ecosystem of what they're doing around television, or should they be looking to have other integrated experiences around TV check-in services or even some of the stuff that Facebook is doing?
So we're at the very beginning of the story, so I think experimentation is key. So I'd advise everyone to experiment frequently and often. There is no final answer yet, right? But when it comes to simplicity and scale, Twitter has the simplicity and the scale when it comes to what you can publicly look at. And I think that's key to training an audience and embracing what an audience is already doing. But absolutely, Twitter should be part of all the different check-in mechanisms. It should be part of the second screen experiences that TV networks are building up. We advocate and we're working closely with ecosystem partners that are building social TV ratings that are 90% tweets, but they also, of course, include public Facebook components, GetGlue, Miso, et cetera. So this is a really complex challenge and a fascinating one, and we need as many smart people involved as possible. So I think we're all in it together, and we'll see where it ends up in a few years.
And finally, Social TV, the book, is targeted for advertisers and marketers trying to make sense of everything that's happening really quickly around television. I'd love for both of you to give your best one-liner piece of advice for the TV advertiser on what they should be doing right now. Robin, let's start.
Yeah. I think, so we see these conversations happen live during the show, but not every contribution is made equal. And often it's the contributions from the producers of the show, the stars of the show, or even a TV critic or a comedian who's like, snarking out the Super Bowl or the, the big award show or whatever it is, that's actually most interesting to most people. So if I was a brand, I'd think about how I could be part of that and how I could either add my voice in a way that, reflects my brand attributes and is actually interesting to people, or associate myself with one of those other back-channel voices that's already doing a great job.
Chloe, what do you think?
I would say that advertisers should follow the creative lead of the best networks and shows that are engaging their audience, because you can take some of those learnings and simplify them for what, a 30-second ad is a 30-second story, right? So what are the best learnings we can take from the VMAs or from The Voice, and how can you simplify that into capturing engagement in the ad itself? Like, we should have the same bar for advertising as we have for shows. So I can't wait until we get to work on a show where all the creative we're putting into the engagement of the show then flows into the 15, 30 or minute long ads and creates its own little ecosystem of engagement. I think there's going to be a really great relationship there.
Exciting time for television. So there you have it. I've been talking with Chloe Sladen and Robin Sloan of Twitter. Social TV, the book, comes out on February 28th, but it's available for pre-order starting now. For more information, you can go to socialtvbook.tv.